when you put that habitat slide up there, are people in your field collecting habitat shots as they collect the insects? Is that a big part of the problem?
It isn't one of the mandates to do that, but that's often the case that we do that. We know what we're not good at with arthropods in general is like field notes. So the fact that we would even have a habitat shot is a big deal. I know for a lot of you fishers and perps, and we're all talking about scanning in your field notes and everything. I thought, gee, that's great. Usually what I get is a little scrap of paper and flyer, but yeah, that's it.
Are you trying to integrate some of those shots with the specimens then?
Yes, I think we would like to do that to provide the specimens. Particularly with the groups that I work on, I specialize on a family of really small spiders, and a lot of the literature just says, well, you know, we only know about two of these, and at the time, you know, from their labels, there's no information on that. So that very tiny insect label that we have means that we lose a fair amount of information, and having something like Sumaiora in the database can hold all the rest of that. So I'm really looking forward to be able to sort of expand where our arthropods, you know, what they were doing and where they were at a given time. Okay.
We have a little time for questions for any of these early speakers. Steph?
I'm just curious, how many people in here know what filtered bush is?
Not really.
Filtered push is a project that's being led out of Harvard. And the goal is actually to create a network where when a biologist edits some data within these systems, these external systems, so right now they're working with Specify, Warpbait, and Symbiota. So if someone goes into one of those systems and makes an edit to the data, like an annotation, changing the identification, it networks all those portals, information systems together, and captures that change and sends it to the other.
Yeah, so that's the push part. It pushes it all out to the rest of us and says, so has made a name change in something. This is who made the change and why. And then we get that information and we can decide or not whether we want to accept that change ourselves. Because that becomes pretty institution specific. You know, then you run into curators who are like, well, I don't agree with that. Pretty typical for most of us, right? I don't agree with it. I'm not going to make that change. Okay, you don't have to, but at least you were notified of it. So it doesn't mean we have to take that, and it doesn't mean that you then have to, you know, take all of your specimens of that thing and you relabel everything, put it under a new name, and you know, well, we have plenty to do. The database will help us take care of that. But filter push, I think, will be a big help in just keeping us alert to the changes, because of all the stuff that
So think of filter push as a way to do things like also find duplicates. It's not just for
personal
annotations. Or and the annotations don't have to be termination annotations, it can be comment. So it's a way that you hopefully connect all the pieces. Some goes to Morphang, because there's an image of a specimen there, and then you can comment about it of any kind, then it could eventually come back to
and which is great because then we don't have to then monitor any all possible comments on
everywhere.
All possible viewers from everywhere it is.
Right.
Yeah. Right. And so it's a great service to have all that come back and say, hey, people are looking at things you might want to consider this or you know
about it. What about like when things are published?
No, but it is coming. It's something that I was talking about time and all people. figure out how many times that specimen is inside.
Right.
The specimen gets pulled down.
Right.
But also, like in Warfang, I think you have the same thing, community practices, when the publish say, you need to put your data here, you need to put your images there, you need to do, I do get emails from them who say, oh, I told, you know, can you update my objects in Warfang so that the Warfang objects can be replicated? So, again.
I was going to say peace. So I think it will come, and that is exactly, it's a bit of a sore point because administrators, that's one thing that they would really like to see is maybe productivity. It's how much your collection is used in all of their ancillary material.
So at the summit we just recently had in the metrics group, it was a big discussion to talk about how not only talk about citing papers, but citing the actual use of particular specimens and making it easy to do that. Say you download 50 specimens and you're going to use that data, which you would actually cite the use of that specimen, and that would then get back to you, wherever you are, but that use would then get back to the provider of that specimen.
So let me ask, are there observations or questions or comments from this last hour that folks would like to make at this point? Additions? Things you're doing? Come on down, don't be shy.
I'm inspired and terrified.
That's a good, honest comment. I love it. Yeah. I don't think there's any real reason to be terrified. I hear folks think, can't do this. I've got one collection manager I work with who says, she's not going to put anything on the web until every record is all done and they're right. I said, well, I'm getting back in the car and heading home. You've got to just start.
Just put it out there. Yeah.
Just start.
Yeah. We got that from Ed and from Paul Heinrich.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Just put it out there.
This isn't necessarily for Sandra, but this was a question that was listed on the notes. When did you find the coordinating the use of all the equipment all the way around?
Uh-huh.
Did you have to have someone who was specifically geared towards that alone in their job? Or was that something just like a situation that was anyone could pick off of it, or did you have someone who actually did this?
It was different per department.
Okay.
Sally, can you re-ask the question? Because you didn't hear.
Maybe come to the mic.
If I understand, can you hear me? If I project a little bit, can you hear me?
Yeah.
How about over there? Can you hear me?
What about the paper?
I don't like to stand up in front of people that try and point. The question, if I understood correctly, is as far as the equipment at all the different departments, was there a person that was dedicated to operating that equipment and doing the digitization work? Is that correct?
But like the coordination of we need to borrow X thing and someone else has that.
Okay.
The coordination of it.
No.
No.
So the question was there somebody coordinating? Right. Was there somebody coordinating the borrowing of equipment? And no. And we were just part of that was my kind of brainstorming. You know, is there a way to coordinate? That's the next step. And I don't know if that would ever even happen. It's we're looking at that. Is there a way to do this? Because we can all. One of the biggest benefits is we can all learn from each other. I think that's the biggest benefit, is we all have things to teach each other, and we all have different areas of expertise that will save other people headaches and time. So I think that's a really great thing. But the exploring and reaching out to find equipment. Like with the CT scanner for the dental school, that's just people just did that on their own. If there was ever any effort to do shared equipment, then I would think it would be a good idea to have somebody coordinating that.
Would there be types of fees involved in your imaginary deal?
That I'll jump away from imaginary and say that there are services on campus that the digital library has a digital conversion unit that you can hire to do specific projects. So if you have, and there may be services on your own
campus that offer similar things. So if you have projects that are different from your typical type of capture, or if it's something that you just don't see it feasible to start that yourself or to purchase the equipment, you might be able to hire somebody else to do it for you right on your own campus. So the digital library conversion unit has both continuous tone imaging capture, which is capturing full color imaging, and that's they have completely different, beautiful equipment now than when I was in that photography position. But when I was in that position and they hired us to capture the Museum of Zoology type specimen collections, we just used a digital SLR camera and copy stand and did that with mammal skulls and with the fish. So, and another thing that has come out of this is that one of the units discovered in the basement boxes of glass slides. And they may, at History of Art, we have a lot of experience with doing not only scanning of slides, but typically it's film slides. These are glass slides that are different mounting than 35mm film. But we have the capability to do all glass slides, like we have lantern slides, as I showed in the slide, the PowerPoint slide. We have the equipment and we have the workflow set up already to do that, and the cataloging. So we're going to do a test run to see if it's worthwhile for them to hire us to do that for them. So there are examples of that kind of thing that are in the
community.
Thank you. Other observations or questions?
I have one. Hey, Mark, I was really impressed by the daunting challenge of the American Museum's dealing with all these word collections. And a big part of the problem I see is just the convention, you know, that we have for treating invertebrates as some kind of an organizing unit of the collection, having federated subsets of, you know, the invertebrate collection, like the mammal collection, you know, well organized and database digitized, but everything else, you know, handled in all different kind of ways. So my question is, do you think that, and I'll just pose this to the whole group as well, as a student, that do you think that it's best just to establish a new way of organizing collections, or just digitize within all of the dealing with all these different conventions and reconcile the problems later? In other words, just a new way of organizing, you know, how we're going to shrink different the taxonomies of all the different things we call worlds. Or just do it and worry about that later.
That's an excellent question. I had an interesting meeting the other night with a person whose theory is that as we move toward complete databasing, that we ought to store collections like Amazon stored products. There's no taxonomy, there's no nothing, they're just on cabinets. And when you need a new cabinet, you put a new cabinet in and you put it in, and the database shows you where it is. And so the idea of storing something taxonomically, or like some pollinated tree or something, makes it sort of, to me, you run that, you know. So if you get this huge infusion of collection material that fits a particular taxonomic place in your organization scheme, and now you need 40 cabinets in the middle of this row, that's a lot of moving stuff around, you know, to fit it in. And this fellow's saying, but if we have it all database and we know where it is, it's all key to some cabinet somewhere, why do we need to worry about that? We can find it using our electronic resources.
And I would never say reorganize the collections. I'm just saying there's a new way of organizing material. This is the digital process.
Our workflow.
Yeah.
Good point.
I mean, it's a trade-off. You know, it's a trade-off between use of the collection and digitization of the collection. If you just keep on adding stuff in cabinets at the end of the shelves, when somebody comes to loan a particular tax on out of your collection, you've got to go and find it in 17 different places in the collection.
Exactly what I do.
So there's a trade-off. There's a trade-off between ease of digitization and ease of use of the collection. And that's what us collection
same argument, sorry.
The other argument also against having things treated like Amazon is that administrators often keep elections as warehouse. And you don't want them to keep going.
That was the term this guy used in his publication for the climate meeting. He said, I'll be out of the warehouse.
As I was gonna say, we use the same argument that Andy just offered, you know, in terms of people coming to actually access the specimens. I'm not sure that it really applies as much as we think it does, but it would be such a great inconvenience. And one advantage I can see in taking on a system, something like what Amazon does, is that you never have to make space within a particular group, which is a nightmare for any collection manager when suddenly a group grows faster than another. So if you're just always adding it on to the end and additional space in the collection, that saves at least as much time, if not more, than searching around for specimens and see what comes to use them.
This guy was talking about drawers of insects, and his vision is that you should be able to pull out any drawer in the collection virtually and look at that drawer and then get specimen data off of those specimens. And that kind of like converting it to move, not necessarily reorganizing the collection, but having a virtual museum where you can say, show me all your drawers and pull out the beetles, and you can go there and look at them all, pull them out one at a time, but it's being virtually. And then say, hey, you know, that unit tray was really important to me, and drawer 18, and this unit tray was really important to me, and drawer 22. I'd like to borrow those or see them or whatever. I think just the whole concept of how we organize the business is important. And one thing I didn't say earlier, I think it's also very important that we mesh digitization and curation in a way that these workflows are complementing each other rather than we have a curation management workflow, collection management workflow, and then we have a collections database management